A very good morning to all. Looking at important headlines from the Hindu newspaper for 1st Feb, on the front page you have Chief Economic Advisor sees growth rebounding to 6%. So the economic survey for 2019-20 has been released, and it seems to be an exercise driven by 20 out of 20 hindsight. 2020 hindsight. So it is combined with an optimistic vision, 2020 vision for the year to come. So it expects GDP growth to revive from 5% estimated for this year to a range between 6 to 6.5% next year. Also, it hints at going easy on fiscal deficit targets so that growth can be rebounded. So it emphasizes on wealth creation also by entrepreneurs. So here you can see, this is how India's economy, which is the fifth largest in the world, compares as such. So these are the top five economies in terms of GDP. So this shows how India is amongst the top five. The Vision 2025 is the goal which India had set to make India a $5 trillion economy by 2024-25. So presently, you can see India is at 2.7 and 2.9 crores. So we wish to double it. And this is regarding fiscal deficit as such too. Fiscal deficit as a percentage of GDP. So that has also been going down over a period of time. But the target to bring it further down will not be fulfilled. It has remained stagnant since 2014 at this. Then here you have Citizenship Amendment Act fulfills wish of Gandhiji, President tells Parliament. So the budget session of the Parliament commenced, and it initiates with the presidential address. So he lauded both houses for enacting the Citizenship Amendment Act. So the Citizenship Amendment Act gives citizenship to persecuted minorities from three neighboring countries, Pakistan, Bangladesh and Afghanistan. So the opposition as such is not to providing citizenship to them. Nobody says we don't want to provide citizenship to them, but then provide citizenship to Muslims as well. So that's the question. Then you have Supreme Court asks UP government to reply on notices to protesters. So the petition has been filed questioning government's arbitrary action. So UP government is now going to explain its notices to certain persons to cough up money for destruction of public property during protests against Citizenship Amendment Act. So Supreme Court is hearing this matter now. And here you have execution of Nirbhaya convicts postponed till further orders. So lawyers say that remedies are yet to be exhausted. So the date of hanging has been postponed now. On page 7, you have probe finds irregularities at Sarthi. So Sarthi is actually Chhatrapati Shahu Maharaj Research, Training and Human Development Institute. So it has been just few months since it has been formed, and already irregularities worth crores have been unearthed. So it has been 8 months ago that it was formed. So it was formed under previous BJP government. Sarthi is registered as a under Companies Act as a non-profit government company. So it works for it is a company for research, policy, advocacy and training for socio-economic and education development of Maratha, Maratha Kunbi, Kunbi Maratha, Kunbi communities and families dependent on agriculture. But here now it has been seen there are irregularities which have come forth. And below you have no funds, wind up probe, says Bhima Koregaon Commission. So the secretary of Bhima Koregaon Commission, which was set up to look into the riots of 1st Jan 2018 in which one person lost his life, has written to the chief secretary of Maharashtra recommending that the inquiry be wound up because there are no funds now. And the chief, it letters to chief secretary says that the government is not serious about this commission, about this inquiry. So this is important because Bhima Koregaon incident has resulted in this allegations of urban excels being used people, academicians, dignitaries who gave speeches here, they have been arrested as urban excels And the case after Maharashtra saw this Maharashtra Vikas Aghadi government, the coalition government coming in power, BJP losing power, the case has also been shifted from the state to NIA, National Investigation Agency. So that is there. So this is an important Bhima Korega dispute issue. On the editorial page, the first editorial is unfounded optimism. So this is regarding economic survey's forecast of 6 to 6.5% GDP growth in financial year 2021. But it is said this is premised on hope. So there's no rationale behind it. And this is India abroad. So this talks about diplomats abroad who are spending most of their time trying to keep out negative references to India. So with respect to Citizenship Amendment Act and revocation of Article 317 Jammu and Kashmir and the curbs posed that, so this has resulted in negative image for India, and diplomats abroad are trying to correct this, rectify this. The lead article is A Sneeze, a Global Cold and Testing Times for China. So for China, the coronavirus outbreak is more than the health crisis. It is a credibility challenge domestically and globally. So it is going to affect China and is having global repercussions too, you can see. And this is Thinking Beyond Farm Shops. So this article says that India needs well-tailored farm measures to balance the national requirement with farmers' aspirations. So, it's talking about how agriculture can be given a boost that benefits both the nation as well as the farmers. On Saturdays on the op-ed page, you have Ground Zero coverage. So here this is a coverage on Marudu demolitions in Kerala. So the dusts have settled now, but processing the nearly 26,000 cases of suspected coastal regulation zone violations promises to be a gargantuan task, a huge task in a sense. So that is there. So there's fear among coastal communities, and concerns of ecologists are also there. So the government is confronted with these challenges now, because there are these developments, infrastructure has come up which violate coastal regulation zone norms. On page 12, you have parents resist CWC notice to keep children away from sit-ins. So this is Central Welfare Committee which has given notice to, or this is Central Welfare Committee of Lucknow, which has issued notice to parents who come for an Anti-Citizenship Amendment Act protest. So they have been issued notice that parents bringing children to the dharna site should not be they should not bring the children, and they should immediately send the children home. But then parents and the notice says that this is in the best interest of the children, so that there is no negative impact on their psyche. But parents and protesters say that their children want to participate in the demonstration, and also there is no other option. They cannot leave the children alone at home. Who will take care of them? Then on page 13, you have coverage on economic survey. So this is an interview with Sanjeev Sanyal, who is the principal economic advisor in the finance ministry. He says the focus on the economic survey is to make a case for wealth creation. And he says there is more space for intervention on monetary front than fiscal front. So monetary policy is decided by the RBI. Fiscal policy is basically on loans, the government borrowings, which will result in taking care of the deficit. Says monetary policy intervention is needed. So we have seen how monetary policy committee has also modified the repo rate. It has increased the repo rate earlier too, but then it does not pass on to the economy, and it has also not been successful. Then here you have no evidence of wrong estimation of growth. So economic survey dedicated a whole chapter to clear the air on misestimation of growth of Indian economy. And also here you have Essential Commodities Act is outdated, must go. So the economic survey says that centers imposition of stock limit in a bid to control the soaring prices of onions over the last few months actually increased price volatility. And this act is outdated and it should go. And here you have another issue picked up on high fees at institutes of higher education. It says this pushes poor and underprivileged out of the education system. So, Jawaharlal Nehru University fee hike is in news significantly. Also, National Sample Survey 2017-18 shows an increased participation in the education system as one of the indicators as such. It says course fee, which is 50.8% at the all India level, including tuition, examination, development fees, compulsory payments, accounts for half of the average expenditure of basic course. So this is a financial constraints are the reasons for not pursuing education for many. So this issue is also picked up by Economic Survey. And also it talks on regulations for startups. It says fewer regulations are needed for startups. Ease of doing business is critical. That is shown here, you can see. So it's Chief Economic Advisor Krishnamurthy Subramaniam who spoke on this. And it's recorded in Economic Survey. So here you have how at World Bank's Ease of Doing Business rankings, how India has improved over the years is shown. And this is stubble burning incidents come down. So the Economic Survey raises concerns over farmers continuing this practice every year, but also it highlights that how the cases have come down now. Then here you have a chance to chart China-like export trajectory. So integrating assemble in India for the world into make in India can exploit parts of value chain is what Economic Survey says, that India has an unprecedented opportunity in this. Assemble in India for the world. So this is also there, and Make in India policy is also there. So both can be integrated, and this can raise the export market share of the country to 3.5% by 2025 and 6% by 2030. So that is the growth trajectory charted by the Economic Survey. So it says India must focus on a group of industries referred to as network products, where production processes are globally fragmented and controlled by leading multinational enterprises within their production-driven global production networks. So a strategy similar to the one used by China to grab this opportunity, which is specialization on a large scale in a labor-intensive sector, especially network products, should be undertaken by India too, is what the survey says. Then here you have bigger banks needed for $5 trillion economy. So Economic Survey says that every rupee invested in public sector banks, 23 paise, for every rupee, 23 paise is lost. So country needs much bigger banks to become a $5 trillion economy. At least 8 banks, such banks are needed, which are large enough to belong to the top 100 banks globally. So there is now only one bank in the country which is at 55th rank, which is State Bank of India. And this is Thalinomics, the formula behind one square meal. So this says for an average worker in India's organized manufacturing sector, the affordability of a plate of vegetarian food comprising rice or roti, dal and sabzi has improved 29% from 2006-07. So this is Thalinomics, a take on economics of food by Economic Survey. And for non-vegetarians, affordability has risen 18%. And below you have pro-business policy vital for India to become a $5 trillion economy. So India's aspirations to become a $5 trillion economy depend critically on promoting pro-business policy that unleashes the power of competitive markets to generate wealth on one hand and weaning away from pro-crony policy that may favor specific private interests, especially powerful incumbents on the other. So survey speaks on this. On international page, you have World Health Organization declares virus outbreak a global emergency. So now World Health Organization has finally declared the viral infection, new coronavirus, as a global emergency. And here you can see it says our greatest concern is its potential to spread to countries with weaker health system. And the death toll has already increased to 213 now. And this is Brexit brings a new dawn for UK. So we saw 31st Jan 2020 was the day Britain exited from EU. So 47-year long membership of EU has ended now. Then on business page you have privatization. Survey suggests new vehicle. So economic survey says public sector units performed better than their peers after privatization. So it pushes for privatization of PSUs. So you can see. Then below you have food inflation higher in urban areas. So economic survey notes tighter monetary policy in case of food fuel price shock. So sudden change in food and fuel prices, that is, you know, these are headline inflation. So this is of a concern. So, you know, urban, both in urban and rural areas. So economic survey highlighted higher food inflation in urban areas. So this is the coverage on that. So economic survey deals with this too. And it wants tighter monetary policy for food and fuel. Then this is core sector grows at 1.3% in December 2019. So growth of the eight core industries, you know, recovered to 1.3% in December 2019 after remaining in the negative zone in the previous 4 months. So now it is in the positive. Expansion has taken place in core sector growth. And here you have GST collection passed 1.1 lakh crore in January. So for January 2020, GST collections have crossed 1 lakh crore mark for the third month in a row now. And below you have India has low rates of formal entrepreneurship. So large number of enterprises operate in informal economy and they are not captured by data. So this is what economic survey emphasizes on, that India currently ranks third globally in number of new firms created, with about 1.24 lakh new entities coming up in 2018 itself. So this is also coverage in the survey. So these are the important headlines. And today's newspaper is very important because of economic survey coverage. So this can be separately covered and studied. It's very, very important. So that is it. Thank you.